एवरी आरबीआई सक्सेस स्टोरी इज अ यूनिक स्टोरी इन इटसेल्फ। हर एक स्टूडेंट के पीछे, हर एक सक्सेसफुल स्टूडेंट के पीछे कोई ना कोई एक यूनिक फैक्टर होता है विच नीड्स टू बी रजिस्टर्ड एंड अंडरस्टूड बाय द एस्पिरेंट्स ऑफ फ्यूचर ईयर्स। आई हैव मिस्टर जतिन कुमार विद मी हु क्लियर्ड आरबीआई ग्रेड बी इन द ईयर 2019, हु इज ऑल्सो क्लियर्ड नबार्ड ग्रेड बी इन द ईयर 2019 द सेम ईयर एंड इज ऑल्सो क्लियर्ड नबार्ड ग्रेड ए इन द सेम ईयर इन 2019। So there must have been something unique about his preparation, which made sure that he cleared all these three examinations in the same year after a failure in RBI in 2018. So my first point to Jatin, you is, what was the main unique point or unique feature in your preparation, which changed after the year 2018, which made sure that you cleared all three examinations in the same year?
So what happens is ki when you fail, now you introspect and you realize your mistakes. That happened with me last year. Due to paucity of time, I was not able to revise a lot of things, so ultimately I ended up scoring low. I realized in this exam where there is so much facts you're supposed to mug, you need to revise a lot of at least 5 to 6 times before the exam, and that was my focus this year. I just wanted to be very, very thorough with whatever I was doing, be it from specifying what I wanted to do to revisions. So that is the area I really focused on. And secondly, I would say, sir, I tried to control the controllables. Out of 100 marks, 70 marks will be which you can answer, which will be on the expected lines. 30 marks worth will be which will be surprising. That will be for everyone. You can't do anything about it. But what you can do is you can control these 70 marks. So that was my focus. That was my that was the thing which I kept in mind while starting preparing my preparation for these exams this year.
So when we talk about revision, sabko pata, everybody knows that you're supposed to revise, but I believe 99% of the students don't do it because it takes a lot of effort, it takes a lot of energy, it needs a lot of time, and it needs a lot of managing, micromanaging as well. So how did you make sure or realize that revision is going to be the key to cracking these examinations?
So because if you see the paper of last few years, there is so much facts in the paper. It's not like UPSC where your analytical skills will be tested. This is here the raw facts are asked, the facts which ideally you should not remember, but still they are being asked in the exam. So obviously this is the demand of the exam. So I realized that, and why people don't revise, the major reason I feel what I have realized is ki they haven't specified their syllabus. Specified their sources of preparation. If you don't do it, and if you read everything and anything that is there in the market, you'll never be able to get the time for revision. So for revision, first of all, you should specify your sources. After that, you can only think, okay, these are my sources. Now I'm going to give 10 revisions of it. And you have to be very sure, okay, this, if I'm preparing from this material, and if any question is from this material, I should be able to answer. That was my approach. Other questions I'm not able to answer, it's in a way okay. I'll take an educated guess there and theek hai. But if something comes from here, I have to answer it.
So the revision of the entire syllabus help you in the uncontrollables as well? It certainly did help you in the controllable part of the syllabus. Did it have an impact in the uncontrollable areas as well?
Definitely, sir. Because what used to happen last year, if I am attempting 10 questions which I am taking an educated guess on, only 4 to 5 were right normally. This year, I have realized in all the 3 papers, out of 10, I will get 7 to 8 right. So what I have realized ki, if you're controlling the controllables, your knowledge is very much certain. You're not unsure about a lot of things. So that in a way helps you to extrapolate and mark questions which you don't know by eliminating or whatever method you use. Ultimately, you'll find the right answer. So that really helps.
So that increases the confidence, the certainty. Definitely. Inside you, and that has an impact on the uncontrollables.
Definitely, sir. Definitely. I try to attempt the entire paper. I don't want to leave anything. So even if I'm not sure of a lot of questions, I'll take a guess. most of the time. So in that aspect, my controlled guesses were much more, you know, much more correct. And also, so what happens is ki in a paper, you if you're like AIR one also, then also you won't be knowing more than 40 marks of questions with full certainty. Other 60 marks of question, there will be some uncertainty, and you have to make an educated way with whatever way you want to do it, right? So this aspect is really important for this.
If I look at your interview scores, in RBI 2018, you scored 25 on 50. But in 2019, you have scored 37 on 50. And in the same year, your scores in NABARD, Grade A and Grade B have also been very good. Now, in 2019 RBI, there has been very erratic and unexpected kind of marking in the interview, ranging from as low as 2 marks out of 50 to as high as 47. What made sure, or what were the things that you did in the interview for the interview prep, which made sure that you increased the marks and at the same time made sure that in such an uncertain environment of interview, you ensured that you got good marks?
Sir, after last year, I scored pretty badly in interview. So this year, first thing what I did was I write the answers of the expected questions, because my profile is a bit unique. I come from a very different background from what RBI, what other aspirants are from. So I expect a few questions that will certainly be asked in every interview. So last year I didn't write answers for those, and that is why I deviated from whatever whatever I wanted to deliver. I was not able to do that. So this year, first of all, I there were like some questions which were certain. I wrote the answers of it, and I stuck to those answers only.
So basically, you picked up your biodata form, identified the core areas, and from those core areas, you wrote certain expected questions which could be asked or which have high chances of being asked in the
exams. I sent my biodata to a lot of knowledgeable people. I took their advice, what could be asked. Then I framed some questions which were, you know, after collating points from everyone. Then I wrote the answers. Then I refined those answers by taking views of others. Then that answer was final. So that really helped, because I expect my initial interview, at least for the 10 to 30% of it, to be from those lines. And actually, it did happen in all the interviews. And in an interview, if the initial part is good, in general, you end up well. So that was my funda, okay, this 20 to 30% of it, I should own it, because I'm not very sure ki what other things they're going to ask me from. And specifically coming from a non-banking background, I was not very, very comfortable with the banking questions as well too, because that was not my forte. So I was like, I should score in this part specifically. So that was...
So can you give me some examples wherein these were your core areas and you prepared answers and they actually came in the examination, in the interview?
Yeah, sir. Because like the first question in every interview was like, why do you want to come? Because I did my BTech mining from IIT Kharagpur, then I got placed in Coal India Limited. That is the best core company for me. And so it was a very good career path for me, and coming to economy and finance and banking was completely different. So I have to justify it. And I was working in Coal India from last 2.5 years when I gave the interview. So it was a quite a long time too. So I had to justify this shift. So so every interview they did ask me, and this time what happened, since I wrote those answers and I prepared those answers pretty well, I was able to satisfy them. They looked satisfied with that answers.
So what was the answer that you gave to this question of Coal India Limited?
First of all, sir, I told that the question was ki you are not justifying your education. That was the basic core of the question. So for that I answered ki sir, I justified the education because I worked in Coal India Limited already for 3 years. After working for 3 years, I have realized ki this is not my area of interest. And this will not be in the interest of the company that I serve an organization without my full effort. So it is better that I go to my area of interest. It will serve both me and the company better. So that was my answer. And in a way, they looked satisfied. And also, I after not clearing RBI last year, I cleared DBF, Diploma in Banking and Finance, because that will be ultimately converted to JIB and you get an increment also. But my I did DBF only because it I expected it will really help me in interview to justify my point, because I added this. कि दिस वॉज नॉट अ इराटिक एंड रैश डिसीजन विच आई टुक ओवर नाइट. आई रियली फॉलोड माई पैशन. आई टुक डिड अ डिप्लोमा. आफ्टर डूइंग दैट डिप्लोमा आई वॉज वेरी सर्टेन कि या दिस इज द फील्ड ऑफ इंटरेस्ट आई वॉन्ट टू गेन. सो दिस DBF पॉइंट आई फील रियली यू नो एडेड टू माई to justifying my position here.
This year you got into NABARD,
yeah,
grade B before RBI.
Mm-hmm.
So I believe they asked you this question as well. Mm-hmm. Why now do you want to move from NABARD grade B to RBI grade B?
Yes, sir.
It's the same area.
Yes, sir. That was the question, and I was very, really happy in the interview also when they asked me this question, because during the mocks we had a discussion and you told this is a very probable question they will ask. Your advice really worked for me there. You told me this is the question you don't answer, this is the question you dodge. So I was very well prepared for this, and the person was very satisfied there.
Because there is no real answer to this question.
There's no real answer, sir.
They're actually equivalent in a lot of aspects.
Yeah, sir.
So convincing the other person is very, very difficult.
Very difficult, sir.
Yeah. What were the other points in the interview that you kept in mind this year, which were different from the last year's prep?
I always take biodata form very seriously. Because I feel that, in interview, you should always try to direct the interview. And that you could do by two things. First is your biodata form. Because if there is a lot of content in your biodata form, which are relevant and true, provided that, then the interviewer will most certainly ask questions from your profile only. And obviously, you'll be more comfortable answering from your own profile. So I focused a lot on biodata, what I want to highlight. Like, I have a hobby. I follow cricket. So I'm like, I wanted to highlight this. I wanted them to ask questions from it. So I mentioned it twice or thrice, whatever achievements I have in this. And fortunately, three panelists asked me only from cricket. Like 10 to 12 minutes were only given for cricket. And I was extremely comfortable with that. So in a way, I was driving the interview there. And secondly, you can drive the interview by the way you answer. Whatever keywords you use in an interview, that will certainly make the next question for you. So in these two ways, I try to do the, you know, direct my own interview.
So when we talk about cricket, I encounter a lot of biodata forms wherein students don't really have a hobby. A lot of students don't have hobbies. So they mix hobbies with pastime, watching movies, listening to music. If you actually have it as a hobby, then I think you should mention it. What is your take on this?
Definitely, sir. You're completely right. Hobby and pastime are two completely different things. A hobby is something which you're very serious and passionate about. So you should be very, very thorough with whatever it is there. So that is why I have seen a lot of people write listening music and all these things. These are not your hobby. Everyone does that. And if you have a passion for it, be very sure that whatever they ask, you are able to encounter it. I only wrote cricket because that was one thing I was extremely comfortable about. I was like, my knowledge base will be more, if not more, than on equal terms with a person. So in that way, hobby... be very sure whatever, not just hobby, in even if you're mentioning the achievements of yours, there can be questions from there,
right?
So whatever each and every word that you write in your own biodata, you should be like completely prepared to answer any questions from that.
So Jatin, there is an underrated area in the arena of interviews, and that is interview etiquettes or social etiquettes. I think that they matter a lot, but they're not given that much importance in these examinations. How did you make sure that you had these etiquettes ready for the exam?
It is probably the most important part of an interview. That is your body language, the way you present yourself. People think the way you answer only matters in an interview, but it is not so. The time from the way you even knock the door and ask to come in, right from there to sitting down and greeting them with a smile, all these things matter a lot. It helps to create you that positive vibe. One thing which I have been constantly able to do, though even I didn't clear RBI last year, I was able to make the vibe very, very joyful in a way that I made the panel laugh. And in a way, even though I made a blunder last year, I got 25. That was decent. In a way, I made such a big blunder. And this year, I was able to score really well in NABARD specifically, and now in RBI too, because of that. Because every time in all of those interviews, I made the panelists laugh, and it was more of an interaction rather than an interview. So in your body language and your etiquettes will help you there.
So how do you inculcate those things? For example, I think that if you truly believe that, you should be very humble to the board because they are so senior to you, they have so much knowledge, which you certainly don't have, then, your ego of trying to answer every question, trying to be perfect will go down and you try and understand, their perspective better. So were there any other aspects that you actually inculcated that helped you? Get those social etiquettes ready and right in the examination, in the interview.
I feel you very rightly said they're very, very senior and very, very knowledgeable person. So first of all, thing you should do is respect and be polite. That's what I really feel. I do it in general life also. So, and secondly, with interview, what I really feel ki you should be very receptive to what they want to hear. And that will happen only when you speak less and listen more. That doesn't generally happen. People blabber a lot. So I specifically try to understand and listen more and speak less. That was my funda. Because your answer should be very crisp rather than long. So that really helped. And if you speak a lot now, a lot of times what will happen that you're speaking things which you are not supposed to.
Right.
I specifically took a note ki, okay, I have to stop there. My answer has to end here.
And then I have to understand what the interviewer wants me to say or what he wants me to add.
Yeah, sir.
Yes. Jatin, phase two is an area where you have scored consistently well in all the three exams. NABARD grade B, grade A and RBI grade B. So starting with ESI, which is probably one of the most dreaded areas in phase two of these exams. What were the key areas which helped you score consistently well in all these three exams?
ESI is probably the toughest of all three papers because there is so much to prepare and the scope is so vast. So my focus on was on the things which are repeating every year, which is quite a certainty if the paper is on expected lines. So if you see the two markers, which is like 70 marks, so it was my key focus. In that, you will find two to three passages of schemes, one to two passages of reports, and there will be general current affairs related question. So my focus area was on these three aspects. Very, very specifically, I dedicated my efforts for it. Like for government schemes, I made my own notes. And those notes were extremely comprehensive. It took a lot of time to make those because it was very extremely comprehensive and well researched out. So these three things I focused on.
How did you make the notes of government schemes? Because that is something that is a doubt among a lot of students. Ki government schemes cover to karna hai, but how?
Government schemes, what I did, I took a base source. From that, I got the basic facts of it. After that, I went to the ministry site. I took a few points from there. So basic details, I got it from there. So that after getting those details, I tried to find the chronology of that scheme. It won't be there for a lot of schemes, but it will be there for a few schemes. And lately, from the last 2 years, they have been asking schemes which are which came before 2000.
Right.
But if you see those schemes, they are not asking the schemes before 2000, which are completely erratic. They will have got merged to become the scheme which has been launched now. For example, if you see NRLM, NRLM came in 2009 or 2010, and it has its roots from SGSY in 1997. So that question was there last year. Many people thought ki it was erratic, but it was not. It had its roots from this scheme, which is very, very recent. So that chronology, deciphering that chronology helped me a lot. I did that in that my own notes. After that, in the last 6 months or 6 to 8 months, whatever current affair, if it is there, that I got from PIB, definitely. So I collated it in my notes. So these three aspects, the basic data facts, the chronology, if there is, and the current affairs, if there is. So I did this exercise for the entire schemes. It took me around 1.5 months or so. But after 1.5 months, I had a documents of 60 page. And I didn't do anything else for government schemes for all these three papers apart from that. And having a 60 page document was a blessing in a sense that I was very... I revised the document multiple times because it was such a small document. So that helped me in revision too.
You talked about PIB. So I remember when you came last time for the interview for NABARD, you were the one who told me, sir, PIB se kafi questions aane lage hain. And I have done it from PIB and it really helped. And I think you should start because nobody else is doing it and it's an important area. So I made sure ki wo point inculcate ho, and I started with PIB in February 2020. It's still going on for this year's students. So PIB, how relevant do you think it is? Or PIB ke saath kya aur multiple sources jaise vision ya kuch aur uthane ki zarurat hai ya nahi?
No sir, I do. If you are doing PIB, you don't have to do anything else. No other current affairs source is required for you. Because and having said that, PIB is too comprehensive in itself. That's why I say everyone, if you are doing PIB, just make sure you're making the notes. Because you can't revise PIB directly from the website.
Right, of course.
And if you are doing PIB, you should not do anything. And specifically, you mentioned vision. I would like to say vision has its focus on UPSC. It is more on analytical terms. And in our exam, analytical things are not asked. It's pure facts. So I don't think it will help in this exam that much. That's what I have realized.
You're talking about facts. So how did you make sure ki bahut zyada facts bhi na padne pade? You don't end up reading a lot of facts. And at the same time, you don't end up reading too little facts. How did you make sure that that balance was maintained when it came to facts?
That was done by defining the sources. I was very, very specific. See, in the market, you have so many sources. And so I was like, I'll define my source. It took some time because refinement takes time. After refining what I have to do, like I had four sources, I was like, I'm not going to study anything else. But I have to make sure that whatever comes, a question comes from these sources, I have to answer.
Right.
So I was very, very adamant on that. And I didn't see anything else after defining my sources.
What were the other areas? Government schemes ho gaya, PIB ho gaya. There are areas like indices and reports. RBI website, let's leave it for finance and management. So indices and reports is an area. Then static portion. That also has a weightage of 25 to 30 marks. So how much time did you spend on? Because I think they're comparatively easy. And if you're done with them once, you're done with them forever. So how much time did you spend on them? And how did you make sure that you're balancing them and government schemes? Because you said that you spent 1.5 months on government schemes.
So static things basically comes in one marker. And those are relatively easy, I'll say. Because if you're able to like clear prelims only, you'll I'm very sure ke you will be in a position ki you'll answer those easy questions. Because they're very basic terms and all. In two markers, you won't have a lot of static things. Specifically in ESI, that has not been the pattern in the last 2-3 years.
Right.
But current affairs is a key. I don't know how relevant it is for this year exam. Last year, be it NABARD, be it RBI, it was heavily current affairs dominated. So in two markers, other than a few government schemes, passages and indices and reports, everything else was current affairs. So the focus should be on current affairs, and PIB, as you mentioned, will definitely do that.
Jatin, English is an area jahan pe students are normally unprepared or less prepared, and they often take it very lightly. But I saw your marks and I realized that in 2019 exams, you got very good marks in all three, RBI, NABARD grade A and NABARD grade B. But at the same time, in RBI,
this year's
exam, you got very less marks.
Yeah.
So what was the thing that worked in last year's exam but did not work in this year's exam?
The basic thing in English which I have realized is practice. If you don't practice 10 to 15 essays at least before the exam, you more often than not you'll score less. Last year during NABARD, I practiced essays very well. I wrote like 10 to 15 essays and on all the relevant current affair topics that was there. And I was very certain with my preparation of English, and that translated into marks also in both in NABARD grade A and grade B. But this year, while giving RBI, I already had joined NABARD and I was under training, and because of paucity of time, I didn't write any essays, and I ended up scoring 58 only this year. So from 75 in NABARD grade B to 58 this year. So you can very well understand the key, what is the difference if you don't practice English. So that is the key in English.
So now we're talking about practicing. Let's try and understand how did you practice, because hum log bol dete hain, let's practice, but how to actually implement practicing an English paper regularly? What strategy did you follow? What actually did you do?
In English paper, if you see, essay is the most important aspect of it. So my focus was on essay. For essay, what I did, I saw, like you always tell, what are the important topic before the exam for essay. I took that. I took some topics, 7 to 8 topics from there. I took some topics which were in current affairs at that time. So I had like 15-20 topics. Daily, I used to read a topic in the morning about it. I'll Google it and I'll write the essay in the evening or the very next day. So that practice I followed, and I wrote essays daily. I had a peer group. We used to check exchange and check each other's essays. So that practice I did after prelims. That time I had 15-20 days. So that really helped me. You know, practicing helps in two ways. First of all, you'll better manage your time, because managing time in English paper in mains is the most difficult thing.
Right.
In the other two papers, you have enough ample amount of time, but English time management is the key. So it helped me there. And secondly, I was writing essays of, I practice essays of all the current affair topics. So what happens, obviously you won't get the exact same topic you'll have, you have practiced, but whatever topic comes, you'll have ample material to write. And writing an essay of 300 words is extremely difficult. In the sense, because you don't have a lot of words to play with. So articulating your thoughts is a bit difficult. And if you are a bit uncertain about what you have to write, it will be extremely difficult. So in a way, writing those essays helped me to get those crisp points for essay. So that really helped.
So what you would do is research on a topic, let's say today morning, spend 2-3 hours on it, made your fodder material, which is indirectly going to help you somewhere or the other in the final essay. And then write an essay on the same thing tomorrow. So that you don't remember whatever you have read in the same language. So you're forced to write it in your own language, right?
Even in NABARD, sir, right before the exam, what we did, ki whatever essays I wrote for the like 10 to 15 essays, I read before the exam. So even the topic was not from whatever I wrote, but I had so much material because of all the essays I've written. So the quality of essay was enhanced in a way. And that this time I didn't practice. I went without any practice. So I ended up getting less marks.
Less marks.
Yes, sir.
So Jatin, coming to finance and management, there are certain very well-defined areas and there are certain areas which are dreadful for a lot of students. So let's hear it from you. How did you divide the preparation strategy for finance and management, and how did you actually score good marks in the paper as well?
FM is probably the most scoring paper of all three because the scope of preparation is very limited. Especially if you break it down, management is very easy in terms you only need to understand the theories, learn the keywords and just apply. So those 40 to 45 marks are just sure shot. If you do it well, you'll score full. When it comes to finance, there are two aspects. One is static and other is current affairs. In current affairs, you'll have to do current affairs along with the RBI circulars and FAQs. In static, the dreadful part is numerical.
Hmm.
And that is the most difficult part too. It takes a lot of time, especially for a non-commerce background student.
Hmm.
So you have to focus there. I focused a lot of my energies on numericals, learning them, doing that. Unfortunately, it didn't come. That's a different story, but it will eventually come sometime. From last 2 years, 2 to 3 years, it is not coming. So definitely in the next 1 or 2 years, you can expect. So your focus should be on maximizing your marks in management, then learning numericals and static part of finance. And finance is also scoring, provided you learn it, but it will take much more time than finance.
And what about the current affairs? Because this year I started this series called RBI 247, and Mansi ma'am covers RBI website, circulars, FAQs and Live Mint every day. Do you think there is any scope of anything else which needs to be done in for RBI current affairs, or is this enough and important for the preparation or not?
I guess it is enough, sir. Nothing more should be done. These will cover almost 90-95% of the things are covered, and 5% scope is always there. I think this is sufficient.
So Jatin, thanks a lot for coming here, talking to me, sharing your views. And I think it's very important that these success stories and the unique points behind these stories go to the students, so that jo mistakes aapne kari wo students na kare, and they can clear the examination faster in a much easier way. As a gesture of my respect and my congratulations to you, I have this small gift for you, which has certain important things which I consider and personally feel are very, very important. So I have Amazon Echo Dot here. So I use it every day, and I love Echo Dot, because this is an area, or I can say this is an arena where we have moved from typing to talking. And I use it for Googling a lot of stuff, and it helps me a lot, save my time. And these are some books that I got for you. I believe they've been very close to me. 1984 is something that I read a long time back, and it helped me understand politics from a different perspective. So it's a book written by George Orwell. The unique point is that he wrote it in 1950s when he died. And this book was about the year 1984. And whatever he said actually came true in the year 1984. So politically, so it's a very nice book. And this is about smart people, something that you did follow in this year's prep. This is called Outliers by Malcolm Gladwell. I'm very sure you'll love reading this. AirPods is something that I use every day. I think a lot of people are saving a lot of time, you know, using AirPods. And of course, Trophy is the, you know, most unique and something that has stayed, you know, since time immemorial. So we, I got this written this time, "We Believed You Achieved," that I think goes very well with a lot of students, because I believe that everybody can do it, but it's upon the students, you know, commitment, and you've shown that you can do it. So this is all about these little things that I've got from you, for you. I'm very, very sure you're going to like it.
Thank you so much, sir, for calling me and for this gift. Thank you.